Hi, it's Carrie. I'm a health professions librarian at Towson University's Albert S. Cook Library. In this video, I'm going to give a brief overview of systematic reviews. You may have heard of systematic reviews before, but what are they exactly? A systematic review is a foundation of evidence-based medicine. Systematic reviews seek to collate evidence that fits pre-specified criteria in order to answer a specific research question. They aim to minimize bias by using explicit, systematic methods documented in advance with a protocol. Well-conducted systematic reviews systematically identify, select, assess, and synthesize the relevant body of research and will help make clear what is known and not known about the potential benefits and harms of alternative drugs, devices, and other healthcare services. Thus, systematic reviews are critical in informing clinical decision-making, practice guidelines, and policy. More and more, systematic reviews are being seen outside of medicine and healthcare. Systematic reviews originally came about to answer questions of clinical effectiveness, but they can also be completed to answer other questions related to qualitative research, etiology and risk, prevalence and incidence, public health surveillance, and diagnostic test accuracy. There are a few important things you should know when planning to undertake a systematic review. Methods documents exist to provide guidance in the systematic review process. Be sure to browse the National Academies of Science, Engineering, and Medicine's Finding What Works in Healthcare, Standards for Systematic Reviews, a report that is freely available online, as well as the Cochrane Handbook for Systematic Reviews of Interventions, also freely available online, and last updated in February 2021. Even if you are not doing a Cochrane systematic review, this handbook is seen as a best practices resource. The handbook provides guidance for every step of the review process. In complement to the Cochrane handbook are the MESER standards, also published by Cochrane. It stands for the Methodological Expectations of Cochrane Intervention Reviews. MESER includes standards for conduct, reporting, and updating systematic reviews. It is also freely available on the web. Finally, the JBI Manual for Evidence Synthesis is an outstanding resource that includes guidance for different types of systematic reviews, which may be appropriate depending on your topic. The JBI Manual reflects a broad, inclusive approach to evidence and accommodates a range of diverse questions and study designs. It also includes guidance for umbrella and scoping reviews. It is freely available online. There are other guidance documents available depending on your discipline. Next, there is a reporting guideline for systematic reviews and meta-analyses. It's called the PRISMA statement. PRISMA stands for the Preferred Reporting Items for Systematic Reviews and Meta-Analyses. It includes extensions for protocols, abstracts, searches, and more. The PRISMA checklist, part of which is pictured here, includes items that should be reported in your review. In addition to these guidance and reporting documents, you may want to familiarize yourself with the overall systematic review process. A 2018 article by Bora et al. Found from 195 systematic reviews registered in Prospero, a database of prospectively registered systematic reviews in health and social care, an average of 5 author team members and 67.3 weeks to completion. This is important to keep in mind. Systematic reviews need a team and time. Let's look at the 6 fundamentals of a systematic review, as outlined by the National Academies in their Standards for Systematic Reviews report. Step 1. Initiate the process. Organize the review team. Develop a process for gathering user and stakeholder input. Formulate the research question. And implement procedures for minimizing bias and conflicts of interest. A 2015 publication by Rethlefson et al. Found that having a librarian co-author on the review team correlated to higher quality reported search strategies in general internal medicine systematic reviews. If you plan to work with a librarian or information specialist, be sure to bring them in at the beginning of the process. Step 2. Develop the review protocol, including the context and rationale for the review. You may choose to register your protocol in any number of protocol registration platforms, such as Prospero or the Open Science Framework, OSF. Step 3. Systematically locate, screen, and select the studies for review. your librarian can make significant contributions to conducting an expert, comprehensive, reproducible, and documented literature search in multiple databases. They can also help you optimize screening and citation management workflows by suggesting various tools. Step 4. Appraise the risk of bias in the individual studies and extract the data for analysis. Different tools exist for this process depending on the types of studies you've included. Step 5. Synthesize the findings and assess the overall quality of the body of evidence. This step may or may not include a meta-analysis. Meta-analysis is not always necessary or appropriate. Step 6. Prepare a final report and have the report undergo peer review. In other words, work toward publication. I always find it helpful to look at well-done systematic reviews in my field or discipline, and also check reported items against the PRISMA checklist to ensure proper reporting. The systematic review process won't seem so arduous if you take it one step at a time. In summary, both methodological and reporting guidance exists, and you should familiarize yourself with them before you get started. Systematic reviews require a team, planning, and time. I hope you learned something new from this video. Leave a comment down below, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel if you find it helpful. Librarians are here to help, and I would be thrilled to hear from you.